dolls and cuddly toys have been purchased because that was something that was very dear to her. Because she was a very feeling person. I think you probably get that idea that it was emotion, it was all about love, it was the feeling aspect.
Welcome back to the Shtick. You've seen just a little bit of the guided tour. We had a lovely lady called Jill Nichol who did a guided tour for us on Sunday. And I filmed a little bit of that. And she was looking at many aspects of Mirka's life, especially her artistic penchant for angels and the lost childhood she had in being a victim or a survivor of the Holocaust. She wasn't a victim because she had a miraculous escape.
Yes, so I think Mirka's paintings are very positive and everything is very optimistic. And in a way, I think most of what Mirka has painted actually are self-portraits. When you look at it, it's Mirka is in every painting. She's done her whole life, she's done self-portraits. Her glass was never half full or whatever. Her glass was always full.
Always.
And she was, you know, like sometimes I would just pop by her house, you know, either when she was in Berkeley Street or when she was in Richmond. And it was always, you know, she never cooked for me because she never really cooked. But, you know, I always had the whatever.
But she had canapes. How do you say it in French? Canapes.
Yes, canapes or macarons. Canapes. She always had things. Or she always
had something in the cupboard.
She was always good coffees and good
tea.
Yeah,
good coffees, and she'd have beautiful baguettes or crackers with cheese.
She always had something.
Yeah,
well, fruits, olives.
I loved her olives. I always asked her, where do you get your olives? You know, she had a secret place.
She always had something. Yeah. But I said, it's certainly... So it's kind of interesting to see, like, obviously Mirka had a lot of things in her apartment, and it was very hard to get through her place, as you've been there.
So yeah,
you
yeah.
know how difficult it was to go from one end, to actually go from the entrance to the kitchen table.
Yeah, her placement of things, though, was like, because she came into my antique shop, and the first time she came in, she
would have been a customer.
Of course, yeah. Well, there were two things. We have to talk about this exhibition that's on at the moment. Which we went to on Sunday. And what happened was the family decided to put everything into Joel's auction. So they had a huge Leonard Joel affair, like the Mirka Mora sale.
Yes.
It was magnificent.
Yes, mine was.
And so what happened was they wanted to make sure that they had something of hers.
So the idea is to actually eventually have a Mirka museum.
Mm.
And this was obviously the opportunity for, it's actually the Mirka estate, not the family. It was
the
estate, because the estate, Mirka Mora estate, owns everything. The idea is for Heidi to be able to purchase all the best stuff or all the things that you would want to see in a Mirka museum. And and the idea, the plans are to have a dedicated Mirka Mora museum at Heidi.
So the cottage you were telling me at the end, which I rudely interrupted you about the John and Sunday.
Yes, so John and Sunday. So the cottage where the exhibition is taking place, which is called Heidi One, is actually the house where John and Sunday Reed lived with you know, a lot of other artists, including when Sidney Nolan lived there, and you know William, as you filmed, William was talking about watching television. Surrounded by Ned Kelly paintings.
Correct.
Without quite understanding what it meant.
He had no idea how valuable those paintings
correct,
were.
Correct, but I suppose maybe they were not that valuable.
No,
back then.
Nothing, just another piece of art.
Correct. And so the idea is obviously they've got three exhibition spaces at Heidi, and the idea is to have a dedicated space that would just be dedicated to Mirka.
So they're going to build something? They're looking to build a building?
So the Heidi are developing a business case, and I know there's very strong interest from the state government to help. So the idea was, how can we make sure that the things that are really interesting, some of the dolls, some of the teddy bears, some of their brushes, some of their easels.
Thus the prices went through the roof.
Correct.
Because there was an amount of over $200,000 that was raised.
Correct.
Plus it was matched by the state government.
So Martin Foley and the state government and Daniel Andrews.
Yep.
So I know Daniel Andrews, the Premier, is a big fan of Mirka.
Yeah.
And I, you know, obviously at the memorial, Daniel Andrews spoke very warmly of Mirka. Mm.
She was the first woman, or the first, you know, like person.
But she was the first woman artist who got a state memorial. Funeral. But I don't think many women actually get state memorials.
No.
So,
no,
and I would say she's the only one. She never got an Order of Australia or anything, so I would say she's must be one of the only one that never had an Order of Australia either. Because normally, when you get a state funeral,
You'd have a few titles.
There are a few other titles, but you know, she was she got prizes from the Melbourne City and things, and obviously she got the French award, but she never got an Order of Australia, which she should have got.
Mm. So therefore, now we have this exhibition. It's on till
March 24, I think.
No, it's on until August 25th.
Yeah, something like that, yes.
25th of August. So you've got a chance now to go to Heidi Museum.
And it's free.
And it's free.
And it's an immersion to her world. I think it's very important. And it shows another facet. It's not just paintings. It's some of her things.
But it wasn't until recently that I really, really understood what it was all about.
I actually think... Mirka has been rediscovered or has been looked at differently since her passing.
Mm.
And I know a very, very prominent art person in the art world told me one day that, as explained before, being her art being shadowed by her naked bum or other things, the day that people will just look at her art, people will realize that she's an exceptional and a very significant, if not the most significant, female artist in Australia of the 20th century.
Mm.
And
well, that's what Willie
it has
said.
Happened.
That's
it has,
what William
it has
said
happened.
At the when he spoke.
Yeah, it happened really quickly. And and there also, I think, to have 3,000 people at the Palais for her funeral, for her memorial, that was pretty exceptional. All the outpouring of grief when Mirka died, which was quite, surprised me.
It was huge.
And the fact that in a week, the design files raised $200,000 as crowdfunding.
The design files, that's the people. Yeah, there's a board, there's a list of people who gave. And I'm sure,
correct. More, and I said, the Mirka for Melbourne campaign.
Yeah.
And it's amazing that she's touched so many people compared to other artists. Because people can see her art at the mural at the Flinders Street Station or the mosaic at the end of the pier or in, bookstores.
Not to mention Mirka Lane off Barclay Street.
Correct, which is just around the corner where she lived.
We'll be back after the break with a little bit more. We'll end this show with a bit more of Mirka Mora because I think she's worthy of as much adulation as we can lay on her.
We could talk about Mirka for hours.
Hours. We'll see you then after the break.